an old friend's reunion that leaves you with a smile on your face and wants to give your pals a bear hug. Hello and welcome to Talkietive Reviews, the 5 good things, where every week we tell you about a new film. And today we'll be talking about the film Christopher
Robin.
A.A. Milne's very famous series, Winnie the Pooh. Christopher Robin, in fact, was his son. And the series was based on his adventures with his stuffed toys, including Winnie the Pooh, Tigger, there was Piglet, Eeyore, and who else was there? There were quite a bunch of them. Yeah. Rabbit and Owl and
Kangaroo.
Kangaroo. There were two of them. The baby one is called Roo. Actually, can you believe it? All these stuffed animals were actually bought for Christopher Robin, and they have been preserved in the New York Public Library, I'm told. Isn't that fascinating?
Wow. Yeah.
And now you have a series based on it. Some movies have also been made on this particular story. Have you guys watched these movies earlier or read any of the books?
I haven't read the books, but I have seen television shows. When I was a child, it used to air every evening on the television.
Right. What about you, Jeet?
Neither, nor the books or the television show.
So you made up for the lost time by watching this film,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
You know, I think the writers of this particular film, Alex Perry, who does a great job, and Greg Booker,
yeah,
I think I have to call out the names because they are exceptional. This is a child's story and it works at two levels. It's written really simply, so it works at the level of children where it's easy to understand. And yet it has these undernotes and little layers, nuances, which makes it also an adult story. Because the story begins at a time when Christopher Robin, the younger one, is saying goodbye to all his childhood friends. They even have a tea party to sort of say bye to him, and they're all kind of feeling really sad. And then Winnie the Pooh and Christopher Robin, as always, sit on the tree trunk looking at the sunset, and they give each other a warm hug. And the bear says to him that, "Christopher, are you going to forget me?" or something to that effect. And he says, "No, you silly old bear." And you know, they hug each other. And it's that moment that all of us experience in our lives when we're going to make a transition, you know, when our loved ones hope that we are not going to forget them.
Yeah.
And we believe that we are not going to forget them, but we do. Life happens and things change. And so it is for Christopher Robin. Things change from that point onwards because he goes to a boarding school, he grows up, he goes to the war. The world war is going on at that time. He goes to the war, he comes back, he has a family, a wife and a daughter, he has his work, and yet he's not all that happy. And then suddenly, his friends from his past come back unexpectedly into his life. And the little sort of notes that the small incidents that they maintain, the simplicity of the dialogues, I feel that it kind of appeals to both the youngsters as well as the adults. Jeet, I think you had a point of view on that.
Of course, you know, it is really fascinating to watch moving bears and stuffed toys in a real world setup. It is really something very different to me. The story, even though I am not the breadwinner of my family, I could connect with the character so well. You know, there were moments where I almost teared up, but then I said, no, I'm not a kid anymore. But it's a kind of impact that the movie has, which I think if my parents watch, even they will cry.
Yeah, absolutely. Nothing leads to something, right?
Yeah.
What a thought. And then, you know, there's the performances, the leading man, Ewan McGregor. I think he's superlative. I don't use this word often enough, at least not so much for actors, but he is, you know, because he's really walking on thin ice, holding this teddy bear, talking to him, laughing with him, getting angry at him, getting exasperated with him. Now, we've seen actors do a little bit of this with children, with animals, even aliens, and sometimes shooting them and all of that. But this could end up looking silly, but he's not, you know, he's very endearing, very convincing. And I think a lot of that comes from his background of having done a lot of musicals, whether it's theatre or movies. And he pulls it off with great elan. And there are the sound actors, Jim Cummings as Winnie the Pooh and as Tigger. He's fantastic. I was told that he's done this for the last 30 years.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
And the two voices are so contrasting that you can barely believe that it's the same person. I thought that they really pulled it off well. Right. But there was a bunch of other very talented actors. Did you guys like the stuffed animals and how they were coming across?
Yeah, talking about stuffed animals, I really liked Piglet. She's like very meek, very shy and a little nervous, but she has a really big heart. And Nick Mohammed's voice definitely suited her character.
True, she doesn't, even though she's nervous about things, she doesn't abandon her friends. She joins them in the adventure. What about you, Jeet?
Yeah, Eeyore, oh my God, he's so funny. It was voiced by Garrett, Mr. Brad Garrett. He brought so much liveliness and jolliness in that screen, you know, with his music and song.
True. I think all of them, he was like, you know, always you could depend on him to be pessimistic. The glass was always half full. But that brought an element of humor and it really worked.
Yes.
But none of this would actually fit in well if it was not for the wonderful production design, you know. Jennifer Williams, the head of production design, I think deserves a shout out for the work because it's really two different worlds. Hmm. There's the make-believe and there's the real world.
Right.
There's a 100-acre forest, there's London. But they really need to look like extensions of each other. And that's a huge responsibility. Otherwise, you know, it could just fall apart visually. And even the cinematography is pretty good. But so therefore, I think these aspects deserve a mention because if they hadn't done their jobs well, we probably would not have enjoyed the film so much.
Yeah, definitely.
And even the drawings, you know, the drawings in the original book, they kind of come alive because you feel like you're flipping through the chapters of a book and then suddenly it turns into a movie as well.
Exactly. Yeah. So the transition, you know, it comes like from the book to the real world and then back to the book. The transition is so seamless, you know, it doesn't give you a moment of disturbance at all.
True. In fact, those few hours that we were watching the film, I was completely transported into this make-believe world of Winnie the Pooh and Christopher Robin, and that obviously deserves a shout out to the director Mark Foster because, you know, at the end of the day, the director has to pull it all together.
Yes.
You know, he has to make sure that the perfect balance is struck.
Right.
And that, I think, happens beautifully in this film. That brings me to the last but not the final aspect of the film that I really enjoyed, which is the music.
Yeah.
Now, normally, animation films, and particularly Hollywood animation films, they have great background score. It's very perky, lively, and strikes the perfect chord.
Right.
You know, in this one, there's more than background score.
Hmm.
There are songs, just like it is in a Hindi film, but of course in a different way. And in Hollywood movies, you also have musicals when you burst into a song and then you have this whole dance. But this is not that zone either. But the songs are really sort of sweet. They tell you something about the film, they tell you something about the character, and they definitely make the film perk up, the mood perk up.
Yeah.
You guys are like Hindi, you know, movie song buffs. What did you think of it?
So I really like this song, Busy Doing Nothing. Like, it's got that Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin vibe to it, and then you're transformed into like that era of music.
Correct. I mean, I completely agree with that. In fact, I would say that that was my favorite song as well because it tells you so much about the movie. But Jeet had a different choice, I know that.
Yes, my favorite was Tigger. Uh-huh. Oh my God, his song and everything was so pleasing. I enjoyed his character.
Yeah, he's like bouncing all over the place, introducing himself. I'm this and I'm that. And it's really cute.
Right.
But, you know, Busy Doing Nothing was my favorite song.
Definitely.
It comes right towards the end when the credits are rolling out. It's a lot more detailed. But by then, you've got, an understanding of what it means. You know, there is more to it than meets the eye. And we've seen that being repeated a couple of times also. And there is a connection to the story, a very strong one. So I thought that was a masterful way of ending the film. Ending it on the perfect note, actually. That's all from us this week. Those were the five good things. And if you like this video, then hit the like button, subscribe to us, follow us on social media, and keep watching. Thank you.